Bob checked the time there, so I guess I have 3.5 hours, right?
Okay.
Preach it.
Bob, look.
Uh-oh.
Hallelujah. Early on when I came to the Lord, there was a change, and in that change, there was an outward excitement and zeal to do something.
We didn't right away get the vision to do this. It wasn't long, but we didn't get it right away. And we had a Christian couple there that were friends of ours, and we would get together and pray and do things. And what we wanted to do was rent a hall somewhere in St. Catharines and just have worship on a Friday night to draw people in off the street just to worship on a Friday night. They'd hear the music, we'd open the doors. There's a couple spots in St. Catharines in the rougher areas of town that they had those kind of venues. But anyway, that didn't happen. It kind of fell through. But we were in prayer, and Raymond, the guy, he got in our prayer, he got a scripture. And in that scripture, it was the first time that I heard of it in that detail. I've read it, we've been Christian. I was born again like a year or two, I think, and on fire and wanting to do something and just couldn't sit still, wanted to do something, and I didn't know what to do. Just wanted to do something. I got into the jail first thing, and Lord opened that door, right? But then he got a scripture, and the scripture was, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. And unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. And that resonated with me when he got that, because he said he saw it on the banner at the house. It just was up there in vision and spirit. And it resonated with me that it opened my eyes that God didn't want us to do that. Not that he didn't have it for somebody else to do, because I think it happened with other people, but that wasn't what he had for us. And that scripture resonated to me. So it came to me today. The scripture came to me today, and that's what God wanted me to speak about. It's in Psalm 127, and it's verse 1. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. There was two things that jump out at me here. Two words, basically. Labor, works. Labor, works. Works in vain. And the watchman. The watchman is in prayer. Works and prayer. Spiritual warfare, prayer. And what it's saying to me that if we're in those works and we're doing those things, whether it be the works or be the prayer and doing the things we're doing, if we're doing it in vain, it's futile. It doesn't mean anything. It could be, as a believer, we could be doing these things. And that's, it's given to us as a believer. Unless the Lord builds that house, the labor in vain will build it. Now, the word house is used in three different, maybe more than that, ways in the Bible. The house could depict you. The house could be the person, right? In the Bible, it's spoken. The house is spoken in ways about being a person. No man can enter a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he first binds the strong man and he spoils his house. Jesus was talking about the body. He wasn't talking about demons can come in the body. But if you can't bind me up if I have the power of God in me to cast them out and keep them away from me. The house, the body. The house, your family. The presence of your household, your family. And the house being a worship area with family and brothers and sisters in Christ. It's depicted in three different ways right there. And the psalmist is saying, and this is Solomon who wrote this one. Solomon only wrote a couple psalms, and this is one of the ones he wrote. And why do you think he wrote it? Because he could back up what he was saying. Solomon could back up what he was saying. Because he tried building a lot of things without God's will. So we can learn a lot from that. There's two things here we have to look at when I'm looking at that scripture, and two ways of looking at it. Either God's building us or we are. I experienced that when we got that scripture back in St. Catharines. Either God's teaching us and leading us, or we are. You with me? And a lot of times we don't even know that we are leading and God's not. But a lot of times we can be in prayer, we can be doing things, and all of a sudden things are going wrong and they're going astray. And they call the pastor, you know, what's happening? Something's wrong. Well, unless God is building the house, you labor in vain who build it. You may be laboring and doing things, but if it's not going right, if there's doors closing, you've got to be wise enough to see that and move away from it, or you're going to keep going in that and there's going to be destruction because you're not hearing from God anymore. Let's go to Haggai chapter 1. If you don't know Haggai, it's in the New Testament. It's right after Jude, before Philemon. What? Where are you getting that from? Who told you that? It's actually in the Old Testament. Praise God. Hey, guy, let's go to chapter 1. Let's start at verse 5. We'll go to verse 5. We'll go up to verse 10. Now, Haggai is speaking to the people, to the believers, to the Jews. Now, therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but do not have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but when no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put into a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the temple, that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified, says the Lord. You looked for much, but indeed it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away. Why? Says the Lord of hosts. Because of my house, that it is in ruins, while every one of you runs to your own house. Therefore, the heavens above you withhold the dew, and the earth withholds its fruit. Praise God. So what was happening here? Unless the Lord builds a house, I labor in vain who build it. What happened was they started to build God's house, and they got tired of doing it. So they started building their own houses, building up the way they wanted to build it. Two-story, nice brick house with a jacuzzi on the back deck. Two chariots and four horses. Indoor plumbing. I don't know if they had indoor plumbing back then. Anyway, they were getting the best of the best, God says. But you know what? Everything you were getting was being wasted away. It was being wasted away. Why? Because they weren't putting God first. They weren't doing the things God had asked them to do. They weren't following His ways. They were following their own ways. And that's what happens to us. Bags with holes. You're making the money. Come on, you guys can relate to that. You make the money and it's gone. Where'd it go? What happened to the money? You're bringing it in, God said, but you're losing it. You have no idea where it went. Because we're not letting God lead our life. See, we know that and we learn that. The newer guys haven't got to that point yet. But we do have to put God first in our life. Jesus said the two commandments we should abide by: love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. And the second one was to love your neighbor as yourself. To give. to give. To give is better to receive. Amen? This isn't something that's going to come from our thinking. It's not going to be coming from our labor. It's going to be coming from God. And when the Holy Spirit is moving in us and we're laboring with His lead, He blesses it then. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, His righteousness, and all things get added unto you. There's an order for that, right? Seek God, do the right things. Do the right things. No, I'm worried about my own house. Now see, in that labor, I'm fixing and doing their own houses. God's talking about the building there, but I'm talking about the house inside. In this day and age, we have that issue. People looking for that inside. People aren't looking for the inside of God, bringing them closer and closer to Him. They're looking at the outside things, and we get distracted by that. Therefore, my people go into captivity because they have no knowledge, because they don't understand. I pray for my daughter-in-law. My son's wife. You know, they're expecting a baby, and she's wandering off into Lilydale somewhere looking for spirits to talk to dead people. She calls herself a Christian, but yet, how can we have the two? It's not biblical. You understand? It's not biblical. We don't run around for if we're laboring in vain when we start running around looking for things. God is right here. He's in you. He's giving you the strength. If the Holy Spirit is upon you, that's where your power comes from. It doesn't come from anything else. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through Him. There's no other way. And God said to Haggai, tell your people, consider your ways. What are your ways? Your ways are of the world. Your ways are seeking all other things but me. My house is here in ruins. My house in here is in ruins because you're not seeking any more of it. You're seeking everything else out there. The distractions come and they pull us away from the truth. They pull us away from the truth. Let's go to 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians. Did I get on you, David? 3:5. Thessalenka. It's easier than to say Thessalonians. First Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5. If I get there, here we go. For this reason, when I could no longer endure it, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter had tempted you and our labor might be in vain. Paul's looking at it like his labor may be in vain because they're being tempted to do things. They're starting to worship angels. They're starting to look at other things. They're starting to take their eyes off the cross. They're starting to take their eyes off Jesus, the only way. They start getting diverted. They're starting to look for mediums. They're starting to look for all kinds of crazy stuff. That's happening in the world today. It's happening right now. How can you sit there and call yourself a Christian and then run around doing things looking for other things? Why? Because you've allowed the house to become in ruins. You're not really seeking the truth that set you free, the truth that set me free. Why would I want to go anywhere else? Like Peter said to Jesus, where should I go? You're the Christ. Amen. When Jesus was sitting there telling everybody, the 500, the 600, whatever, that you must eat my body and drink my blood, everybody started murmuring, Eat body, drink blood. This is crazy. It's cannibalism. I'm out of here. Bible says 500 disappeared. 500 disappeared. Why? Because they didn't allow themselves to see it from the spiritual understanding of things. 12 left. Jesus looks at Peter, and that's when he said, you want to go too? And that's when Peter said, where am I to go? You're the Christ. There is no other way. Where are you going to go? You labor in vain everywhere you go. So Paul's telling us, be careful in this verse. Temptations will lure us away. Temptations will lure us away. I've seen it happen even right here. Distractions, temptations. The Bible says God doesn't tempt us. The tempter does. And the tempter is another word for the devil. And his cohorts. That's all they want to do is pull you away from God. Why? So they can kill you. So they can seek and destroy you. Ruin your life. Ruin everything about you. Get you in a corner somewhere underneath a box with nothing. That's where the devil wants to keep you. But Jesus has given us victory. But you know where the deception comes in? And that's why I believe Solomon wrote this. It's because the people that think they have it good, people that have it good, they're enticed. The distractions have taken them away, and they have all these things, and they take out the neighbor's garbage, and they're doing all these good things. But yeah, they're doing them for the wrong reason. They're laboring in vain because they're not doing them for what God has given them to do. When he showed me that scripture, when we were looking for that big venue thing to do, and it caught me. It's like, wow, I'm glad we didn't go down that road because that would have been the wrong road and who knows what would have happened then. Because that wasn't for us. But are we aware of it? Are we even listening to God when he's telling us things? And when I say, are we listening to God? It's the Word. It's the Holy Spirit in you. It's others that are with you, that speak to you, that resonate in you, that give you conviction through the Holy Spirit that it's truth you're hearing. Only the Holy Spirit can do that. No medium can do that for you. No fortune teller can do that for you. The Bible tells you to stay away from that. Specifically, the Bible says get away from it. First John chapter 2, verse 15. So Paul says in Thessalonians that the temptation will lure us away, distractions will lure us away, we'll begin to labor in vain. And John continues with this when he says in verse 15, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Why? Because you're leaving the house in ruins. So it isn't. He isn't in there. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of the Father abides forever. Worldly labor. We get so caught up in the worldly labor. I need that car. I need that house. I need this cottage. I need this whatever. I need. I was there. I need. The more I had, the more I wanted. Nothing was ever satisfying me. If I had a car, I wanted that car. If I had that car, I wanted that car. If I had that car, I wanted that Escalade in the parking lot. I want that car. No, but it was never enough, is what I'm saying. The worldly lusts, you're never satisfied. Because you're laboring in vain. You're laboring in vain. The lust of the eyes. You see it, you want it. The flesh. You feel it, you take it. The pride of life. The pride of life, that's the biggie. That's the biggie in all of us. Because that's what we're born with. The seed of Adam planted in us is the pride of life. And unless we're born in a Christian family and raised in a Christian family very young, and that's not even a guarantee, but you don't understand that. I didn't understand it. I thought number one was to be number one. I mean, get out of my way. You know, I had to have everything better than you and everything above you. Because that's what the world teaches, is it not? If you're not number one, forget about it. They don't even talk to number two. Never talk to number two. Nothing in the world edifies number two. It's all about number one. And that's what teaches us. It teaches us in the business world. right? You want to be the CEO, not the assistant. And that's what pride does to us. It takes us in that place with distractions that lure us away that we may labor in vain. We may labor in vain. And don't be fooled. That happens in the Christian walk. You see it in churches all the time. Churches start moving in the wrong direction. I was talking to a gentleman yesterday at the park. It was his teacher. A teacher when he was going to a renowned Christian school. That teacher eventually, when this person graduated, wanted him to start a church with him in a certain community. And then that all took place. But then, before you know it, he has a relationship with his secretary and leaves his wife and boom, took off out of the church. So, if we're laboring in the Lord, would that take place? No. We're laboring in vain. And even in a Christian walk, we can labor in vain. Don't be misled. You can labor in vain. That was my whole thought early on when I talked about that venue. Didn't want to go there because I knew it would be the wrong thing once the Lord brought it to our attention. And I know if this man was a man of God, things were brought to his attention because God says he will always give us a way out, but it's still our choice to make that choice to get out of it or not. But it's the pride of life. Let's trade in the older woman for the younger woman. Pride of life. I don't know what the thoughts were there, but that's the thought that the pride of life is going to generate, amen? Has nothing to be with equally yoked. No. You're running in the flesh. You're running in the lusts. And we do that in the world. We run in the lusts. We don't take time to sit back and listen to God. We want to run with the next thing, with the next thing. God doesn't push, right? Who pushes? The devil pushes. And God doesn't interrupt himself. God does not interrupt himself. So what will it profit a man if he gain the whole world but lose his own soul? That's what Jesus told us. We take time to absorb that, to think about it. Gather up your treasures in heaven, not on earth. Jesus speaks this. What is he speaking? He's speaking spirit. Eat my body, drink my blood. Gather treasures in heaven. They all go hand in hand. It's all in spirit, not in what we perceive in flesh. First Timothy 6:7. Bless you. First Timothy 6:7 says, "For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out." Now, you know, I guess some of the Egyptians misunderstood that. You know, someone like King Tut and different ones, you know, they got buried with their dead cat. They got buried with all kinds of different things, right? And they're still there, but he's gone. Thinking he could take it with you. You can't take anything with you. From the ground where the dust we came, the dust we go back. Amen? We can't take anything with us. Well, I want to leave a legacy. Okay? Jesus' legacy was dying on the cross. Think about it. Your legacy. Your legacy. Your legacy, it's so easy to just get distracted from that legacy because pride is seeping in. I don't care who you are. Pride is seeping in. These guys, Paul, John, Peter, Jude, the ones that wrote the Bible, didn't talk about any legacy. The Holy Spirit led them. They died, and if the Holy Spirit and God's in it, it'll continue. Amen? Amen? Just like when they were chasing them and trying to kill them after Jesus died and rose from the dead, and the Holy Spirit came upon them. I forgot who it was. I think it was Gamaliel, where he said, you know what? Remember such and such, I forgot who it was, when he thought he was God, and, you know, he disappeared, and, you know, we just left it alone, and it all just dissolved itself over time. He's talking to the Pharisees, right? I'm paraphrasing, but it's in the Bible. And he went on to say, you know what? If this is from God, nobody will stop it. But if it's not, it'll dissolve just like it did with this other guy. So they agreed on it. You know, they're trying to chase these apostles around, trying to kill them, and the power of God just getting stronger and stronger. We're not living for legacy. We're living for the power of God to produce those things that He wants us to produce for Him, to give Him the glory. Then when we're gone back into the ground waiting to be taken with Him, He can take that work and put it back to work. All Paul knew was when he was getting his head cut off when he was writing 2 Timothy. He didn't say, you know, tell my friends come over and let me leave this legacy for you. No. That was it. His legacy is in the Word of God, but it had nothing to do with him wanting to leave a legacy. It was what God wanted. It's what God wanted. That's the difference. We're laboring in vain when we start moving in that direction. Don't get me wrong. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all things get added onto you. Yeah, you got family. You want to leave things for family. That's a blessing. But it's not the legacy. The legacy is you want to make sure that they have God, and that God is number one in their life and leading their life. That's the legacy. Why? Because nothing else matters. It doesn't. All your cars, all your houses, all your boats, all your property, everything's going to burn up. Everything's going to burn up. The only thing that's going to be left is your spirit and my spirit. And I pray your spirit's up there with me. We can't take it with us. Got to give it back to God. So is all labor in vain here on earth? Is all the labor in vain that we do here on earth? No, it's not. Not all labor we do is in vain. First Corinthians chapter 3. We'll start at 13. And go to 15. 15? 13 to 15. Paul is saying, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it'll be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on, it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Praise God. There is a reward for our labors. But the reward for the labors is, we have to remember, is in the Lord, not in our own. And on judgment day, I don't know, you know, where you're at. I don't know where I'm at. All I know is on that judgment day, they're either going to be rewards or they're going to get burned off. And Paul's saying some of us are going to get so burned off that our underwear is going to be burning on our way into heaven. Going to basically barely make it. We're saved, yeah. We're going to get there, yeah. But who are you serving? There is reward for the righteous works, for the works we do for in the Lord. Psalm 90:17. You guys to my left, are you awake over there? Ninety 17. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us. That's what we need to pray, that God would establish our works so that we know that we're doing them in the Lord, we're not doing them in ourselves. You know what? I'll give you a good litmus test. When you're doing the things for the Lord, sometimes you'd rather be doing something else. At least that's what the thought process would be going on. But the thought process going on, you'd rather be doing something else, is coming from the devil, because he wants to distract you to do something else that you shouldn't be doing. In other words, when you're doing the works of the Lord, most of the time it doesn't feel that great, because you'd rather be doing something else. But the rewards after that, when you see it, it doesn't feel good. Why doesn't it feel good? Because there's an enemy out there trying to pepper you to get you away from it, to distract you, to pull you away, like Paul said in Thessalonians. He doesn't want us laboring in God. He wants us to labor in vain. So we got to have God establish our thoughts. Some of you may not believe this, but you know our last enemy is in our head. I can't give it to you. You got to get it yourself. But the Holy Spirit gives you the understanding. You have victory in Jesus Christ. You have victory. And the only one who limits that victory is you or me. Because God has given us all things. We are more than conquerors. Let's go to Judges chapter 7. Still got 2 hours left. Hallelujah. It's getting warm in here, though. Does anyone hear of Gideon? I'm sure you guys heard of Gideon, right?
Yes.
Not Giddy. Gideon. Gideon. Gideon was a judge. And a lot of you know, and maybe some of you don't know, but judges were raised up by God to set Israel free. But what would happen is a judge would set Israel free. They'd be free from their enemies. They'd get complacent. The house becomes in ruins. They start laboring in vain. And God sends another enemy to wipe them out and put them in prison. Then over time, they cry out enough. They repent enough. God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry I did that. I'm sorry I did that. God hears them. He raises up another judge. And the whole book of Judges, it goes on and on and on. It shows us. You know, a lot of times we think and we say what we say, but we really don't mean it, because the Bible tells us it's true. Many times. But anyway, I don't want to get into all that. That's a whole other thing. But Gideon was one of the judges that God raised up. The house is in ruins and Gideon is raised up. Now, there's a lot to talk about in there, but I'm just going to touch on it. Gideon, God speaks to Gideon. And the first thing that comes to Gideon is, well, he's in the threshold. He's wiping it off, and God speaks to him under there. And he's in the lowest of the low places, and God's telling him, Gideon, gird up your loins. I'm going to give you victory over your enemy. First thing Gideon hits, what is it? Shame. Unworthiness. Not me. I'm from the tribe. I'm from the lowest tribe. Why are you picking me? I'm picking you to give you victory. He had to convince him. He had to convince him. And you know, that happens in our walk. When we come to the Lord, we have to be convinced by God. He has to give us conviction. He has to show us how he moves in us so that we can continue to seek more and more of him. Amen?
Amen.
And he was doing that with Gideon. He was doing that with Gideon. And he progresses. We go into the fleece. And a lot of you heard about the fleece. He's already given victory. God spoke to him. He's heard God's voice, but yet in his time, he starts to forget and he starts to let fear take over, even though he knows who God is. The distractions, the circumstances start bringing in the fear, like us. But God continues to lead him in truth, like us. But the fleece came and he said, look, God, if that's really you, I'm paraphrasing, but this is, you can read it for yourself. If that's really you, I'm going to leave my fleece outside. I'm going to go to bed, wake up in the morning and let the fleece be soaked and everything around it be completely dry. And I'll know what you got. Next day, that's what it was. The fleece was soaked. But that wasn't enough. He still doubted. Just like us, as we're coming to the Lord in truth, seeking more truth, growing in the truth. The next day he asked for just the opposite, that the fleece be completely dry and everything around it be soaked. And it was. So here God is growing a man of God just like he grows you and me. We're going through those things. But Gideon is holding on to God and what God is telling him. He's holding on to that truth. Holding on to that truth. But now, he tells Gideon he's going to give him victory over the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the ites. They're all gathering together to come against the Jews. God said he's going to give him victory. But see, if we stay in that fear, we labor in vain. We need the truth to keep us from laboring in the vain. The truth will continue to keep us laboring in vain. The truth is what? The word of God. God was speaking to him. He said he'd give him the victory. Okay, so where's verses 12? Well, no. So what happens was, I don't want to read it all. But anyway, God tells Gideon, listen, get up your army. Get all the soldiers together. So Gideon does that. He calls for an arms. They get together. There's 32,000 soldiers. So now Gideon's gaining some confidence. Praise God. Here we go, laboring in vain, doing it the way we see it. I got 32,000 soldiers. No problem. The guy says, oh, wait a minute. You know, that's too many guys. You don't need that many. All the guys out there, the soldiers, whatever ones are afraid, whatever ones are fear, whatever ones have families, let them go home. So Gideon, reluctantly, I'm sure, speaks that. There goes 22,000. So there goes 22,000. Now he's down to 10,000. This is how God works in us, too. So now he has 10,000 soldiers, and he's thinking, you know what, I can still do this. God, I know you're with us. And God says, whoa, 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 there's still too many. What I need you to do, Gideon, is take those 10,000 down to the water and see how they drink water from the river. If they go down, they lap in it, tell them to go home. If they raise it up and look and they drink out of it, out of their mouth, out of their hands, tell them to stay. So just picture Gideon doing this, right? The first 1,000 guys, every one of them lapped the water. They're all going home. Gideon says, oh my gosh. Can one of you guys lift the water up like this? Because 9,700 of them went home. There was only 300 men out of the 10,000 that drank the water like this. Okay, so now what happens? Now God says, all right, we're ready to go. You got your 300 men. There goes the circumstances. Go to verse 9, I think it is. Verse 9 here in chapter 7. Gideon still had a problem. Well, probably had a bigger problem because he had 300 men to do it with. He wasn't trusting God. God is speaking truth. He's telling him, look, I'm giving you the victory. God is speaking truth today. He says he gives us the victory. 300 men, not enough. So God knows there's a fear there. So verse 9, it says, it happened the same night that the Lord said to him, he woke him up and says, arise, go down against the camp, for I have delivered it into your hand. But if you're afraid to go down to the camp, the Pura, your servant, And you shall hear what they say, and afterward your hand shall be strengthened to go down against the camp. Then he went down with his Purah, his servant, to the outpost of the armed men who were in the camp. Now the Midianites and the Amalekites, all the people of the east, were lying in the valley, as numerous as the locusts, and their camels were outnumbered as the sand by the sea of the sand, the seashore in multitude. And when Gideon had come, there was a man telling a dream to his companion. He said, "I've had this dream. To my surprise, a loaf of barley bread tumbled into the camp of Midian. It came to the tent and struck it so that it fell and overturned, and the tent collapsed." Then his companion answered and said, "This is nothing else but the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel. Into his hands God has delivered the Midians and the whole camp." And then basically when Gideon heard this, if you go on, he built up his confidence again. God reassured him by hearing from somebody else what was going to take place. So now he goes back and let's do this. Let's do this. Don't worry, there's a reason why I'm bringing all this up. The same thing happens to us in our walk. Whether you're 21 or 61, some of us have longer life to live, some of us have a shorter life to live. But our life, whether it's long or short, is to serve God and serve Him only. I don't know why I said that, but praise God. But it is to serve Him. But it's a battle. It's a battle. And in that battle, God can show us through Gideon how the ups and downs will come, but we have to stand firm in the truth. God never wavered from what He told Gideon in the threshing floor, "Gideon, get up. I'm giving you victory." Yeah, He's just like us. We divert from Him, we stray away, we do things, but God brings us back if we continue staying in the truth that sets us free. And that's Jesus and nothing else. So he's standing firm, so now he's ready to go. So God tells him, here's the plan. Read it for yourself later, I'm going to paraphrase it. Here's the plan, God says. Get yourself a shofar. Ram's horn was more like Richard's, but get a shofar, get a jar of clay jar, and a light. Now I want you to take 100 men, go all the way around the back of the camp, because they were all in a valley, ready to attack Israelites. So God says, put 100 around the back end, 100 around here, and I want you and the other 100 around this side. So they were circling the whole valley. Actually, I can read it. Verse 16 in chapter 7 says, "Then he divided the 300 men into three companies, and he put a trumpet in every man's hand with empty pitchers and torches inside the pitchers. And he said to them, 'Look at me and do likewise. Watch, and when I come to the edge of the camp, you shall do as I do. When I blow the trumpet, I and all who are with me, then you also blow the trumpets on every side of the whole camp and say, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon.' So Gideon and the 100 men who were with him came to the outpost of the camp at the beginning of the middle watch. Just as they had posted the watch, and they blew the trumpets and broke the pitchers that were in their hands. Then the three companies blew the trumpets, broke the pitchers, and they held the torches in their left hands and the trumpets in their right hands for blowing. And they cried, 'The sword of the Lord and of Gideon.' And every man stood in his place while around the camp, and the whole army ran and cried out and fled. When the 300 blew the trumpets, the Lord set every man's sword against his companion throughout the whole camp. And the army fled to Bethacacia towards Zeruiah, as far as the border of Abel, Mahaloah, and Tabath." Say that three times real fast. But basically what happened there. So what happened? God said, "I'm going to give you victory." They didn't have to lay a sword, a fist, they didn't lay anything on anybody, because God says, "It's in my hands, let me take care of it." And he did. They destroyed each other. And the ones that ran, they caught up with them. The Bible says, you can read it on, and they destroyed them. And God gave them victory. The only thing they had to do was trust in the Lord. Trust in God. The only thing Gideon had to do was trust in the God and believe in the truth. Believe in the truth and trust in Him. But it's hard for us to do if we can't see it. If we're only seeing the circumstances, it's hard for us to trust. That's where the poo-poo hits the fan. You've got to make the right decision. And the decision is to follow Him and labor in Him, not in vain. Because when we're laboring Him, no matter what it is, He's going to give us the victory because He says so. Victory is yours. And then you look at the whole thing about the clay jar and the light being in the clay jar. You know what? When you become a believer, you get the light inside of you. You get the light inside of you. The shofar is the power of God. The power of God blown through that shofar. Jesus is going to be blowing a shofar when He comes back. Bible says that. He's going to be blowing a trumpet. The trumpet's the shofar. He's going to be blowing a shofar when He comes back. A spiritual warfare taking place in things we can't see. But it's happening. It's happening. So He's blowing. We bring the shofar, the earthen jar, the jar vessel was to be smashed. Why was it to be smashed? It was to be broken. That's in remembrance of me and you. Our flesh needs to be broken so that the light can shine. You can't truly serve the Lord in the Lord without breaking that vessel, and that's you and me. We got to break it off in order for the true light to shine. Otherwise, we're laboring in vain. Some of us have chinks in it. We haven't truly broken it yet because we're still laboring in vain. We're still doing things we shouldn't be doing. We're still laboring in those things thinking that God's got us doing them, but He doesn't. He's telling you, you know what? Crack that jar right now. Smash it on the ground. Let the light shine. Break it off. To be last is to be first. To deny yourself, pick up the cross and follow me. There was a lot of scripture that God was speaking to you guys before we started this service. That's all resonating right now, isn't it? That's because the Holy Spirit is in all of us and He speaks through all of us. But we got to let it go. If we don't truly let it go, He won't let His light shine on us. And a lot of times we're going to labor in vain and we're going to go back to the same things. Because we truly haven't broken the vessel. And truly only you and God know that. We can see it by fruit, but that's between you and God. God says, break that earthen vessel. Let my light shine. Then blow your shofar. Let that Spirit move. And see how I work in your life. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5. Oh, I think I was just rewarded. I got another hour and a half now. Praise God. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5, 5 through 7. Paul says, "For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Or just 5 and 6. No, 7. "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us." I am determined not to know anything among you except for Jesus Christ and Him crucified. To live is Christ, to die is gain. When you speak these scriptures, you need to mean it. Because if you don't, you're laboring in vain. But nothing else matters, Paul says. It doesn't matter. In this earthen vessel, we have to shine the glory of God, not yourself. Not ourselves. All glory has to be deflected to God. We say that, we go to verse 18 here in the same, where it says, "We do not look at the things that are seen, but at the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are temporary, but the things that are unseen are what? They're eternal." Paul's saying in the same scripture as he's talking about the light and the darkness, we shouldn't be looking at the things we see. We need to live eternally. We have to live for eternity. We have to live for eternity. If you read in Ephesians, it says we're not from this place. We're not from this place. I don't want to blow your mind, but you're not from this place. You're born into this world, but you're not from this world. You're from heaven. And we're to go back to heaven with God if you truly believe. But if you're going to run around Lilydale or some other freaky place and talk to dead people, you're talking to demons. You're talking to evil. Because to be out of body is to be with the Lord. If anyone I believe is truly saved, I'm not going to see them. Only the Holy Spirit teaches me and speaks to me. And angels minister to me to do the things that God's called them to do. And that's it. You want to divert to anything else? You're moving away from labor. You're laboring in vain. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him in all your ways. And then He directs your path. Pretty simple if we follow it, though. We got to follow it. First Corinthians chapter 2. Almost done. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12 through 14. Paul says, now we, that means you, have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which is the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. You can talk to someone all day until you turn blue. If their heart is hardened and they don't know Jesus and they don't want to know Jesus, it isn't going to happen. Not in our time. What we have to do is step away and we have to pray for them and let God work on them. Because at that point, it has nothing to do with us anymore other than the power of God answering our prayers, because we're laboring in the Lord, not in vain. We start forcing things on people, you're laboring in vain. Before you know it, they're going to be slapping you, moving out of the way, get out of my way. You start turning them off. You can turn them away. God's got to be the one who does it. We got to break that earthen vessel so we can let the light shine. But we got to know when to let that light shine and when to move away and let it shine in somebody else. Because again, pride can come in. When pride comes in, we think we can save everybody. Jesus only had 12 following him. It's a quote from, I got this quote, I forgot who it was, but he said, eternity to the godly is a day that has no sunset. When you're living and you understand and the Holy Spirit's living in you, eternity is like having no sunset. It goes on and on. You're living for eternity now. I'm not going to die. My flesh may go into the ground, but I'm living forever. And I'm living forever with Jesus. I'm living with my Savior and my Lord. And if I truly believe that, that means there is no sunset. But he goes on to say, you know what? Eternity to the godless is a night that has no sunrise. Which is true. I've seen true atheists. Now, people can call themselves atheists, but a true atheist has actually gone through every religion, studied it, and decided to himself that there is no God. But I've seen some atheists have so much bitterness in them, with veins popping out of their head and neck, so angry when you talk about God, that you can see that there is no sunrise there. There is no joy there. There's nothing. They're lost. And your heart should go out to them in compassion. I mean, Jesus was on the cross. What did he say? Forgive them, Father, for they do not know what they're doing. And they're killing them. They're killing them. I want to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 through 57 in the NLT, honey. there. What I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die. We will all be transformed. That's an exclamation mark. We will all be transformed. It'll happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet, that shofar, is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. And we who are living will also be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now that's powerful scripture. If you believe. I see faces that don't believe. When I read that, my whole body gets chilled because I know the Spirit in me is telling me this is truth. Don't look at the circumstances because this is truth. I can only tell you, I can't give it to you. God's got to give it to you. But on Judgment Day, you can't look at me and say, I never told you, because I did. I'm telling you right now. Listen. So I want to continue with that, but one more verse. I want to go to verse 58, the very end, but I'm going to read that one in the New King James Version. So Paul says all this, and then he finishes this with this. He says, therefore, my beloved brethren, that's you and that's me, be steadfast, be immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, not in your own. Okay? Knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Who are you working for? Ask yourself that. Am I working for myself, for what I need to gain in this world? And I'm laboring in vain, or am I working for the Lord? And everything I do and touch, he blesses and lets and leads me. Like I said, it doesn't mean you have big cars and big trucks and everything else. You have that in here that nobody can give you, is that peace inside. Nobody can take that away. That's the eternal reward. That's what I'm living for. I don't know about you. I'm a little older than you. I'm 27 now. So.
Me too.
Why are you laughing? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm 37 now. And I have less time to live than some of you guys. I'm older. I have less time than some of you guys. The bottom line is it doesn't matter. Time goes by so fast. And time doesn't wait for no man because it's not about the time. It's about eternity, which is not time, right? You got to ask that question. Are we focusing on him, doing things for him, or are we doing him for ourselves? Unless the Lord builds the house, we labor in vain who build it. Amen? But when he's building it, Philippians 4:13 tells us, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. As long as he's the one strengthening me, I can do all things. Nothing can stop me. But when I start doing it in my way, everywhere I go, I'm going to trip and fall. Amen?
Amen?
Praise God. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for this long-winded sermon, Lord. Thank you for everybody's patience, Father God. And Lord, I ask that the word that was spoken here, that would come deep into the hearts of each one of us, Lord. Father, that something that was said here today would be heard in our minds, in our hearts, something we've never heard before, Lord, that you have touched our heart, touched our mind. Father, lead us in the rest of this day. Bless us in our fellowship and our breaking of bread together, Lord. Lead us in this week ahead for those that are visiting here, Father, loved ones. Lord, let your angels will protect each one of us, to guard us and protect us, your favor upon us, Lord. Continue to bless, Lord, in all the things, all the works we do for you, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.